Hey, I want to say thank you for joining me in my living room. Today I want to talk about the Old and the New Covenant, specifically the New Covenant, because that's what you and I as believers are now living under, the New Covenant. Hebrews 8 verse 13 says this. It says, in speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. Well, hang on. I'm getting a phone call right now. This is from my flip phone. Hang on just a second. And hello? Yeah, I'm ready for you to send me those pictures. I'm hoping that the pictures go through. And it looks like it's downloading. 1%. So I'm not a very good actor. If you could see, this is actually an old flip phone that I pulled out of my closet. And for those of you that have the new phones and the smartphones, you know that this is now what? It's obsolete. And that's what Paul, or the writer of Hebrews, we don't know actually who that was, but we believe it could be Paul. He was writing to the church and saying to them, he's saying, listen, you guys, the law is obsolete and the new covenant is what we are under now. And so I want to look at that context again. And so he says the law is obsolete, but right before this, he says this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, declares the Lord, I will put my laws into their minds. Aren't you glad that he gave us or made us a new creation? Now he was buried, and I'm talking about Jesus Christ. He was buried for 3 days and he rose again and he raised us up with him. And so now we're a new creation and that old man is gone. You do not need to keep dying and dying. What you need to do is you need to know who the real you is. You're alive in Christ Jesus. Now, do we deny our old lifestyle? Absolutely. But the dying part has been done once and for all. When we accepted Christ by faith, we became born again. And so that's all it took. It worked the first time. Now, he said that our mind, he will put his laws into our mind. Now, I want to ask you this. Is he putting 613 laws into the new believer's mind? I don't think so. I think he's putting the law of love. Jesus said this, a new command I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. And so that law of love, it actually covers the entire law. It's just it's the currency of heaven. It's love. It's how heaven operates. And so again, in verse 10, he says, and I'll write them on their hearts. Now, for many years, I was unable to think that my heart was clean. I used to sing songs as a worship leader. For 20 years, I sang as worship. In the first 10 years, I would sing a song like this. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Maybe you've heard that song. It would say something like this. It's from the scripture. It'd say, cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. And then it talks about restoring the joy of my salvation. So the scripture is what David was saying under the old covenant. And so creating me a clean heart, that's not what Jesus did for you and I. He didn't create in us a clean heart. He actually crucified and buried our old heart, and he gave us a new heart. Ezekiel talks about this. I'm going to give you a new heart. I'm going to take your heart of stone, which represents the law. Stone represents the law. And I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. And that represents love, and it represents what he's doing as a new creation. Love is being written on your heart. And according to, again, Hebrews, he's saying that not only will he write the law into your mind, he'll write it onto your heart. So love is constantly drawing you as a new creation. Doesn't mean you can't sin. Does mean that love wants to do the right thing. It's created just like our new hearts are created for good works, and so it wants to love people. Now, he says, I will be their God, and they shall be my people, and they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord. We talked a couple weeks ago about just the reflection of Jesus and how the church can be a reflection of Jesus. Now, it cannot be Jesus. Pastors and churches cannot be Jesus for you. They should be a good reflection of Jesus, but truth is that the church is the bride of Jesus. And so the bride, listen, we have to call the bride beautiful by faith. It doesn't always look pretty. There's a lot of mess, especially in family. You know, when you have kids that are young, maybe there's a smelly house. I remember our house for years smelled like diapers. And so maybe there's just different levels of people and different stages of their growth. And there is growth in the kingdom of God, and you got to allow for that. And it looks ugly, and it doesn't, you know, if you're not used to family, and sometimes family in their growth stages, you know, a teenager's, sometimes they need some growth and they just need some time to mature. And so that's how the church is. And so what I'm saying is they cannot be Jesus for you. And he says, listen, in Hebrews 11, he says, everyone will not have to say, know the Lord. In other words, you're not going to need teachers for you to see the reflection of Jesus. You can know him yourself. That's good news. You can know him yourself. It's not that teachers aren't pointing to Jesus and they are needed. What he's saying in the scripture is that you don't have to rely on them to know the Lord. That's good news, because you have the Spirit of Christ in you. And it says, they shall all, who's all? That's all of us. They shall all know me. And from the least of them to the greatest. Doesn't matter your education. Man, this is beautiful. You know what's funny is some of the least educated people Jesus brought along, and the ones that couldn't see Jesus were the highly educated Pharisees. They were students of the law. They were students of scripture, and Jesus was standing before them, and they didn't see the Messiah. Now, sometimes we have to be careful that we highlight knowledge over knowing Jesus. What do I mean by that? Well, there's the truth, which is Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, but we have to be diligent to be able to divide through the scripture the old covenant and the new covenant. So we're looking for Jesus all throughout scripture. I want to give you 2 Timothy 2:15. Paul's talking to a young pastor, and he's telling him, listen, rightly divide the word. He says, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, dividing that word of truth, knowing and looking for Jesus, he is the Messiah, and the Pharisees couldn't do it. They believed that Jesus was coming in, or many of the people believed that Jesus was coming in to set his throne and be a king and deliver them from the captivity of the Romans. Listen, that's old covenant thinking, to think that God is going to fight your enemies. Jesus kept telling them, listen, you've heard it say to fight your enemies, but he said, pray for your enemies. I want you to know that you need to pray for your enemies and love your enemies. And it ticked off the self-righteous people. For you to say that you need to love someone that doesn't love you, they didn't understand that. And so Jesus understood what love truly is. What love truly is laying down your life for one another. And Jesus said, no greater love than for someone to lay their life down for a brother. And that's what Jesus did for you and I. We can have circumstances change. We can have people in our life be upset with us. But we have to know that the love of God is based upon what Christ did on the cross. This is good news. Now, Galatians 3:19, and I'm coming to an end. Galatians 3:19 says that, what purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. Now, the law was there to point to a Savior. The law was there to say we can't do it on our own. The righteousness that we have has to come from Jesus Christ. And I just want to be careful to rightly divide the word of truth. I want to look for Jesus all throughout Scripture, and I want to make sure that we know that the old covenant is obsolete. Could we possibly go back to a phone like this? Yeah, we can. I don't see any sense doing it. The law was something that was to tutor us in order to bring us to Christ. And now that we have Christ, we're no longer in need of a tutor. That's what Scripture says. And so one more thing. Hebrews 8:12, it says this, I will be merciful towards their iniquities. And he's talking about you and I as believers. And he says, I will remember their sins no more. Well, how is that possible that he remembers our sins no more? Well, you just mean the ones that we confess, right? Actually, he's talking about, this was written a long time ago, so he's talking about your sins are completely forgiven. Colossians says that he's forgiven all of our sins. And this is important to know, because once you know that you've been forgiven, if someone comes along and they don't ask for forgiveness, you can forgive them the way the Father forgave you, because maybe you forgot to ask for forgiveness from Jesus. Doesn't mean you shouldn't ask or you shouldn't repent, but it does mean that you were forgiven once and for all, and that he remembers your sin no more. Isn't that good news? That right there is the new covenant. The old is made obsolete, and the new covenant is what you and I are called to minister to. It gives life, it brings hope, it brings joy to tell people that God is not counting their sins against the world. He is reconciling the world to himself because he loves them and he gave his son for them. And that's the good news that we can share with the world. Not that a disease is here because they did something wrong. That's not the case. The case is that there will be trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer because Jesus has overcome the world. And we need to give them a hope that he loves them and he's for them. And that's the good news. Perfect love casts out fear. I hope this was encouraging to you. Grab your Bible, get into the Word, and look for Jesus. Any questions, comment below. And guys, feel free to share. We'd love for you to subscribe as well. Have a great day.